There's something I've been thinking about doing for a while, working on a retro FPS game, and I think maybe it might be better to get the ball rolling sooner rather than later. At the very least, kind of establish things, get a feel for how long it's gonna take, and how realistic is this, how much interest is there. You know, maybe I can get it to the point where we can get some videos and screenshots and get a Steam page up and see how many people start wishlisting it. And like, if it outpaces Fist of the Forgotten, maybe I need to focus on doing a retro FPS, get that done, and then go back to Fist of the Forgotten. The thing I don't want to do with Fist of the Forgotten is cut it short and like cut off a lot of the potential it has just based off of general interest and stuff. I think it's really difficult to sell a platformer these days, and I think it might be better to work on something I'm more familiar with. Like, I know retro shooters inside and out. Like, that's what I grew up with. That's my bread and butter. That's my childhood. And I also know more people that play retro shooters than platformers. Tentatively, I'm calling this Primble because it's a quake-like. So the name should be like Quake 2, right? Yeah, so I definitely have to have help if I were to get this out sooner. The thing that's challenging is that if I want to make the tools to make it faster to do the levels and stuff, that's going to be a lot of upfront cost at like not making any like visible progress. That's good. Hey, so we moving around. We're jumping, we're moving in our literal gray box world. Game done, ship it. All right, next project. What are we gonna do, shoot 'em up, roguelike? We also need to figure out a grid to texel size. I'm thinking of 32 units being 1 meter because like 64 units in Quake was taller than the character. So if we had 64 units be 2 meters, that's like roughly the same scale as Quake. Quake is, the character's 56 units tall in Quake. So if we did 56 over 64, that gives us 0.875 times 2 meters, 1.75 meters. That's 5.74 feet. Actually, that's about, What is average male height? 176 centimeters. Perfect. It's like exactly that. 175, 176. Where's our collision shape? 1.75. Bam. And there's no limits. I can look up, and I can keep looking up until I'm looking backward. I'm really turning this FPS genre on its head right here. Look at that. Wait, where'd all my help go? I'm helpless. Yeah. What happened to my help? Let's try turning it off and turning it back on again. Thank you.
Bless
there it is.
My child.
Need help finding help? Hey, look at that. We made a cube. We did it, guys. Look at that. Isn't that a nice cube? Look at that cube. So, say this is our ground. So, like, we're going to click and we're going to drag out. Say we click and drag over to here, and then we create the bottom of our box. And then as we look up, we want to create the top of it. I don't know if this is going to work or not. We'll see. Okay. Create an inside out brush. Brush. So first card, the problem card, is the bottom card. So we can see that the little bird here is stuck at the bottom of the ladder. Our immediate solution card is Elmo with the snorkel gear on, which possibly indicates that maybe getting unstuck is not a matter of going up, but you actually need to dive down deeper, find your solution. And a long-term solution card is represented by the circle, which is also Cookie Monster holding two delicious cookies. I think what that means is that it's difficult to come up with solutions to a problem on an empty stomach, and what you should do is get yourself some food, dive down deeper into the problem, and see if you can get yourself unstuck. Well, that's what the system arrow has to say about that situation. 0.245, 1.15. So the min function for vector does not get us the min on all axes. Did it just give us the smallest vector? I think it may have just given us the smallest vector. All right. So what we're gonna have to do is we're gonna do vector three, or mins is a vector three of minimum brush point 2.x, brush start point dot x, brush. Oh, well, there's another problem. It's doing the max of that. Brush top point. All right, so brush top point dot x. Oh, I'm dumb. I did the max of just the first one. One more time. Well, sort of. At the very least, should update the origin to be the brush start point plus mesh box size times 0.5. So we got that going, sort of. Yeah, the size of the box should be updating, but maybe that doesn't update. But yeah, if I set the size of the mesh, like, it doesn't seem to update. Because I'm setting the transform to the start point plus half of the box size, because I want the center of the box to be in the middle of the start and end. And that moves it around, but the mesh itself doesn't update. Like, it's not using the default value, because default is 1 by 1 by 1, and it's clearly changing, unless this is somehow moving. No. The start point's not moving, so the mesh... Let's not talk about this. There we go. No, I was being stupid. I was setting the size to the wrong thing. I was setting size to the start point and not the size. That's why when I would click on it, it would create a different box size, but then it wasn't ever updating because I was setting it to the start position, not that. Anyway, what it's supposed to do, it's supposed to click out like that.
That seems like a bug.
And then bloop, like so. So I'm going for pixel art style, or pixel art texture style anyway. And what I want to do is have the textures actually take the light into account. And so, say you have a texture and it's got like a wood grain and like some metal rivets, classic Quake style texture. And so in Quake, the texture would just have the shadow here, you know, drawn into the texture and the light highlights on the top of these rivets and stuff like that. That'd all be part of the texture. But what I want to do is create height maps. So I could either 3D model these or hand draw the height maps or generate them somehow. And you'd have kind of the base colors. And then if we had light coming from this angle, for example, then we'd have the shadow cast this way because I would look at the texels and I would do a couple steps and see if there's height that blocks that. So then we get like this kind of pixel art style lighting in the texels. And then of course the rivets or whatever would have the highlights and stuff from the light. All right. Well, let's go ahead and start making stuff and see what comes of it. We just need something to start with here. So now we can see that our lighting is dependent on the angle of light. So we've got a light shining down here, and we've got some dark edges on the side. But since the light is mostly directly on here, we don't have that. Although I think we should add a little bit of kind of baked into the texture some lines, because it looks a little weird there. Do something simple here where say if maybe this should be plus that. Oh, maybe that is working properly. Okay. We'll need to do a few iterations, and also, I don't know if I can do this with the information they've got, but I basically want it to snap to the nearest texel. Right now, I've just got it checking if that height is greater than the one next to it. But I want to do it on a per-texel basis, so it would be like that whole texel and not like part of this texel in this weird kind of curvy shape. I could be wrong, but it seems like we're using filtered values here. Ah, we are. So that creates an interesting effect now. Now it looks like little miniature voxels on there. Those are kinda sorta close. What we're gonna need to do is, I think, normalize this and then multiply by exactly one texel. Can I give you a suggestion on a game jam? The theme is post-apocalypse and you don't really know what to do. It's so broad. Well, what you could do is a game about a whole bunch of posts that are just attacking everybody. It's just like there's posts everywhere. It's like Hitchcock's Birds, except it's posts, all kinds of posts, telephone posts, goal posts. Just, it's a post-apocalypse. Twitter posts. That would be good too. Coming up with ideas is easy. It's the execution that's difficult.
I usually hide this because I don't want to scare people, but got two layers of hiding this. There we go. Look how much stuff is open there. Okay, I'll hide it again. Just keep people's anxieties down.
All right, so floor, EV times texture size divided by texture size. There we go, that's looking a little better. It's like not quite perfect. There's a couple stray pixels there. It's better than it was, but I hate these little sparkly pixels. Why can't it just work perfectly? Why is that happening? It's like a bizarro edge case. Yeah, so those rivets kind of highlight the effect that I'm going for pretty well. Okay. Well, I think it's not too bad. Even if this ends up being like what I ship with, this is still pretty cool. The artifacts are still there. They're not quite as noticeable right now. Like, you can still see them right there. Ah, yeah. I don't know if this is gonna cause any oddities when we're super far away, but I don't think so. I mean, I guess the shadows are basically gonna not be mipmap, but honestly, I don't know that you'd really be able to tell. You know, I've been planning on a kick mechanic, but I didn't think about vending machines. Actually, vending machines probably would not make sense in my game because it's gonna take place in like the 1800s. So I'm thinking Victorian era. And as far as I know, they didn't really have any vending machines. That doesn't mean you can't have them. Steam vending machines. You know, I was thinking, I was like, well, I'm aiming for kind of steampunkiness. So it's like maybe you could have kind of a steam vending machine type thing, and then you mentioned that. Darn, now you guys have me actually legitimately thinking about steam-powered vending machines. I don't need to do that in my game. All right, thanks, Mio.
I'm trying to create vending machines in this one new level.
Vending machines? Oh my gosh, we were talking about vending machines earlier.
One vending machine. Okay, let's see. I have a for loop.
As always, a huge thanks to all my patrons for supporting me doing all this crazy game dev stuff. I really do appreciate it. And until next time, you know, I don't know.